At one point, I really realized I want to be surrounded by people who really want to change something. Entrepreneurs, community builders, people who really want to move something around.
It's truly an amazing experience. For me, it was really a good entry point to enter the startup world. So my background is in finance and investing. I went to the Europe conference in London and then attended my first global conference last year and this year again. I met so many interesting people. If you have any hesitations, you truly need to get connected in your local chapter.
Basically, what we do is try to reach for the best speaker possible that will allow founders to learn. You have to meet a lot of people, and you have to create a real connection with those people, focusing on adding value to their lives, but also in learning and helping them in every way you can and to scale faster.
Startup Grind gave me the opportunity to really achieve that. So now I'm running on one of the most active chapters in China and in the world. And I am on a daily basis meeting so amazing people, entrepreneurs, investors, corporates. I'm really grateful being part of this amazing community.
San Francisco, Lagos,
New York City,
Dubai,
Dublin,
okay,
China.
Thank you guys
Hi,
for joining the session.
I'm Paris, and I welcome Mr. Tushar for this wonderful session. He is the founder of Consultancy Ventures and also founder of Saffron First. And he has been consulting Big Four and is a Harvard alumni. And he has been a renowned venture capitalist and venture consultant and advisor to many companies. He has a very vast career, and he'll be introducing us today about more nitty-gritties of fundraising and how we can make our investor or venture more investable. Over to you, Mr. Tushar.
Before we go to Tushar, I just wanted to also say a little bit more about the Tushar. So we are very grateful that he accepted to come on the Startup Grind platform. Somehow we were supposed to meet earlier, but during COVID times only we met. So we are very thankful, and a virtual clap to everyone and to Tushar for joining. So just to bring back the nostalgia, if we were doing this meetup physically, I am very much looking forward one day in March, April, or some coming months to do a physical meetup with all of you. A physical meetup has a different charm itself, a different vibe itself. But here, because of the limitation of the virtual, the technology itself, currently you are forced to see three faces, and we two are not too important. Me and Paris are not too important. Mostly the Tushar. So for him to get that vibe, we would require our attendees to keep write as many as questions, introduce yourself, ask any question, do not think too much. In the end, if everything is fine, we will ask you to come as a presenter on this platform, and we could see you face to face if you wish to open up your camera. So once again, do not think about what you should ask. Just throw questions here. This is a wonderful opportunity for our attendees to come and listen to Tushar and eat his brain. Because if you don't eat his brain, you won't be able to get your startups or your company investable. So this is the journey which you should take. Don't hesitate. Just testing much effort on that. Before we move on, you might have seen in the video that there's a global conference they talk about. Startup Grind has a global conference, and it is for the investors and for the startups. And it is one of the largest conferences which happens, which is happening from last 10 years. This year, due to our unfortunate reasons, it is going virtual. So, but it has also made us more accessible. So stay tuned till the end to know how you could get an entry into this Startup Grind Global Conference. So over to you, Tushar. Sorry to eat up your time, but thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Paras. Thank you, Pranjal. It's my pleasure to be on Startup Grind today. Have been seeing the very good work done by the team at Startup Grind. And, you know, I always wanted to come here and talk to aspiring entrepreneurs and, you know, startup enthusiasts. A little bit brief background about myself. I have a 20-year-old experience in corporate finance and investing. I have worked for 4 corporates, been part of the private equity practice at Deloitte & Touche, was a part of the team at Brand Capital, which is Times of India's fund, invested almost $100 million across companies at Brand Capital. Also headed treasury at the Russian company MTS India unit and raised almost $2.5 billion for the company, and was CFO with a company called DLI, which is owned by Guggenheim Partners. In the last 7 years, I'm part of 2 companies. One is Consultancy Ventures and one is Saffron First. We guide investments in fund in startups and growth stage companies, right from $200,000 to $25 million. And Saffron First is an angel fund of 38 high net worth individuals. Now, coming to the relevance of today's talk, as we know, COVID has hit the global economy and India is also hit. But, you know, there has been a lot of changes which have happened with investors and with startups. I have seen startups pivoting to new business models and investors also having change their investment thesis. So what has fundamentally changed is that, you know, if you look at 99-2000.com bust and then 2008 Lehman Brothers crisis and now COVID, technology is marching on. So whether it is products or services, technology is taking center stage with the advent of smartphone. It is a very sticky product. It has huge stickiness. And because it is very sticky and grabs our attention span, all the products and services are centered around the smartphone. We have seen the valuation of Apple, you know, the maker of iPhone, reaching $2 trillion. So a company which was $1 trillion became $2 trillion in a matter of 1.5-2 years. Also, Amazon saw 40% growth in its business after COVID because people were sitting at home and ordering, and its valuation also became from $1 trillion to $2 trillion. To put things in perspective, Indian GDP, the entire output of the country for the complete year in dollar terms is $2.7 trillion. So, you know, that is the kind of value which has been created by technology. Now, coming to some macro factors, businesses and cross-border trade was hit, and India is a little bit unfortunate. A lot of economies like Southeast Asian economies, South Korea, Taiwan, Japan, they first adopted manufacturing, and after adopting manufacturing, they moved on to services. And the Western countries like Europe, UK, US, their currencies are very strong. So they have a lot of services sector, and they believe more in investment business, not in the manufacturing and hardcore labor-oriented, labor-intensive business. So all those businesses move to developing countries. India is very unique. Our workforce is quite up to date with a lot of latest things in the financial world, because also because we speak English, but not only that reason. So Indian services sector is quite big, and it became quite mature. Manufacturing became mature. So I'm telling you all these things from the point of view of an investor. What has happened since COVID is that health tech came in the front, right? So because COVID made people very conscious about health. If you look at the current government's budget, which happened, health has been given a large priority, and the budget for health has been increased like anything. Secondly, because of the new farm laws, agri-tech came in front. We have been seeing a lot of action happening on agri-tech since almost 6 to 7 months now. Third, if you look at even the most conservative educational institutions, they were forced to adopt technology because of classes being held at home. And so I have been personally seeing like almost, 3 to 4 edtech companies a week, all of them trying something different, right from child psychology to entrance training to content. There is a company which is my client. They have educational content like gamification. So it is very interesting the way they have built content in 10 Indian languages, including English and Hindi. And they are already doing a turnover of 35 crores. So even on health tech, I saw a company doing sports content through gamification. Then, the government removed the monopoly of ISRO in the space sector. And hence, we are seeing a lot of space tech companies as well. FinTech has been strong since many years now. But, the challenge in the FinTech space has always been how you differentiate yourself with the other players who have deep pockets. So if some company is trying a payment gateway thing nowadays, they will have to compete with Paytm. And Paytm has deep investors who have the financial muscle. To give you an example on the FinTech, look at Jack Ma's company, a FinTech company in Alipay in China. 1/3 of Chinese population uses Alipay. And it was valued in the recent stock market transaction. It was valued at $3 trillion. So this gives you a sense of how big FinTech can be. I mean, we are talking about traditional banks going bust. We are talking about the traditional business models around traditional banking becoming totally in the opposite direction and technology being taken over. To give another perspective on FinTech, banks used to lend straight away to people, right? To corporate class and to salaried class. But now banks are thinking of lending to FinTech companies because FinTech companies, they are very efficient in lending. So they use artificial intelligence based analysis of the borrower, his credit profile, and his history of repayments. It decides the risk. So pricing depends on risk. So it decides what interest rate to charge. And it makes it super easy. Like you just press a button and you get your loan. So this is the action which has been happening in FinTech space. You all have seen what Jio did to telecom. It brought the data rates almost less by 90%. And so the data usage has exploded in the country. But another aspect of Jio is that it brought out the Jio phone. And Jio phone is not a smartphone. It is a feature phone. And a lot of the population in India which we call, bottom of the pyramid. So this population cannot afford smartphones. So Jio brought out a feature phone at a very less price and offered some good apps in there. So, you know, I have a client company, they are a fintech company. They have created a technology which will allow banking on feature phones without internet. So, you know, through SMS and by SIM overlay technology. So, you know, all these are very exciting times. On the investor side, let me tell you what changed. The investor has now told its companies to save cash and to have thin teams, lean and mean thin teams, and to plan for the long haul, which means that save cash, have thin teams, stop your aggressive plans, don't be aggressive, play safe, and wait for the vaccine to get rolled out fully and for COVID to get addressed properly. Because till the time that COVID factor goes, the supply chains won't start again. You know, trade is still a problem, which means that supply side is still a problem. People are still working from home, which although technology has solved a lot of that problems, but still business is not as usual. So investor is also saving money on its balance sheet. Investor is saving money for future rounds of its investee companies. And they are picking and choosing which company out of our portfolio we want to invest again. And they want to back the right horses. And invariably, it is the technology horse they want to back. So, you know, this is all a sense of one very important aspect has been intellectual property. So we have funds telling me there is a New Zealand based fund, which is also active in India. They believe in defensibility. Now, what is defensibility? It means if the fund invests and they are not able to get an exit because of bad markets, because of macro reasons or some black swan event happening like COVID, then they will take control of the intellectual property in the company and sell it off. So, you know, that is the defensibility. This is the mindset of these investors. You know, apart from that, agri-tech, health tech, space tech, artificial intelligence and machine learning is going very strong. Deep tech, disruptive tech. I will talk of two companies to give you some examples. One is a robotic company. This company is based out of Gurgaon. It's my client. They have created four type of robots. One is a robo for food delivery through an app. The second one is a robo for disinfecting buildings and workplaces using ultraviolet rays. And if you look at a company in US, which is called Germ Falcon, their robots, they disinfect aeroplanes. And this Gurgaon company's robots are 90% cheaper, more customizable, and a better product than Germ Falcon's robots. The third robo they have is for scavenging. So, you know, the municipal sewer lines and drains, ganda nalas, a lot of cleaning happens through humans. Like, you know, people are sent down the drain. And many of them actually pass away because there are hazardous gases in these sewers. So this company. So, the, yeah.
I'm saying it this, can be a social boon.
It is right. And Supreme Court of India has stuck down manual scavenging 1 month back. So this company has created robots which will do the scavenging. So, you know, what a timely product and at a very cheap price. So another company I want to talk about is a pharma tech company. 1MG, NetMeds, MedPlus. You know, NetMeds got bought out by Reliance at a good valuation, in spite of the losses. And 1MG saw an investor in Tata's. And now there is a company with me. I will tell you how these founders are thinking. Now, MedPlus earns 1 crore per store. This company, which has come to me, they use technology and they earn 8 crores per store, 8 times. So how do they use technology? Suppose you are a buyer from that store. I will give you a report from Capgemini. What is happening is all these startup founders, they are using online technologies, internet-based technologies, like digital marketing, like customer profiling, like data analysis. A Capgemini study happened 20 days back. They took interview of people on the street who were buying from the stores. And 79% Indians, they said that apart from online technology, they would like to see in-store automation. 85% Chinese said they would like to see in-store automation. So, you know, this pharma tech company, I'm giving you an example. A man enters their store. Immediately using facial recognition technology, they are able to understand who this person is. Then the entire history of that person opens up. His family tree, their health problems, where does he live, what price he bought the medicine in the last visit, when was that? The whole thing opens up and it immediately tells him this person is due for medical examination since these many days. Second, this person has a medical history of this and his paying capacity is not that much. So instead of a patented medicine, we should offer him a generic medicine, which is a cheap medicine. Third, this person, has some other problem or something like that. Then a robo, which is in-store automation, a robo goes inside and gets the medicine, just like the Amazon warehousing. So all this technology, and you know, we can suggest a yoga instructor, we can suggest a pranayama instructor or a psychiatrist to this person who lives near his home. We can see on the map and immediately a map will open up and this person will be shown and examples of a yoga instructor, where which yoga instructor he can use and at what price. And the store makes a commission from empaneled yoga instructors also. And also AR and VR, augmented reality and virtual reality, they can be used to tell the customer about all these services and products which the store offers. Then the whole transaction happens on an app. The payment happens without any use of paper. And it's a seamless process. So that's how they earn 8 crores per store rather than 1 crore per store, which is earned by the other startup. So all this is, you know, a window on the technology which is happening. Today's times, if you are not crunching your data of the customer with you by using artificial intelligence and machine learning, you won't be able to compete with others in the next 10 to 20 years. This is how important artificial intelligence and machine learning has become. Now, to give a sense to the participants here about what investors are thinking. If you want to open a startup, if you are not a technology person, it is time for some upskilling and cross-skilling. It is not a time to earn degrees and certificates. All the possible content in the world on any subject is available on Google and YouTube and Coursera and Khan Academy and edX and their Un Academy. You just believe in learning something new. Don't go after degrees. Skill yourself. And if you are not able to go deep in a technology, then you have a co-founder who's a tech guy. Have a co-founder who's a tech guy, because technology is going to drive your business. The investor is staying away from operationally heavy, cash guzzling, which are big losses, those kind of businesses. They want to focus more on core competence. What do you do well? Second, unit economics. They want to see that in the race for capturing the market, you are not losing money per unit of sale which you are making. Third, barriers to entry. Whatever you are selling, suppose it has an intellectual property. So the other companies cannot put money and just learn the technology, because that is a know-how which you have. That is giving you barriers to entry for the new players to get in. Fourth, a lot of data will be generated while you will be running your startup. You should focus on that captive customer base. That customer base is yours. So you should focus on that to attain a good product market fit. Let me give you a very deep insight about foreign investors, how they look at India. They see India as a very price sensitive, quality sensitive, time sensitive market. The expectation of the Indian consumer is the most out of all global economies. So how they see India is a consumption led story. GDP, gross domestic product, it consists of consumption, investment, and exports. Indian exports are around $300 billion, which is not much, nothing much, because we are not a part of the global supply chains. Germany does more than $1 trillion of export, such a small country. Investment. Because the government 8 to 10 years back did bad investment, gave bad loans of almost 20 lakh crores. Out of that 20 lakh crores, 12 lakh crore did not come back to the government sector banks. 60% NPA, which is the bad loan. So investment has not been strong. China has grown over the last 35 years on the back of investment factor in the GDP. They keep on investing in roads, buildings, new parks, new cities, new dams, just keep on investing. So investment is not so strong in India. Exports is not so strong. Consumption is very strong. So we are a consumption driven economy. That is why a lot of you will be wondering why all the funds say we will invest in consumer B2B, consumer B2C, consumer B2B2C, because India is a consumption-driven economy. If you look at India's GDP, there are two ways to look at. One in dollar terms, one in rupee terms. In dollar terms, we are only $2.7 trillion GDP, which makes us the fifth largest economy in the world. But if you look at consumption, India's consumption makes it the third largest economy in the world at $11 trillion. So that's why this, if you have a consumption driven startup, you will do well. Just look at Boat, the phone company, this headphone company, speakers company. They just started 4 years back and they have recently got a $100 million investment in 3 to 4 years. Because India, if you understand the pulse of the customer, there is a huge market. If you are into consumer startup, definitely make use of the data which you are generating. Mukesh Ambani has made a huge amount of his wealth from oil. But, you know, he said in his annual general meeting of shareholders that data is the new oil. Today, there is 6 billion population in the world. Out of 6 billion, almost 5 billion people, almost like 5 out of 6 billion, have been profiled on 700 parameters by Google, Facebook, Amazon, Netflix. And, you know, they understand these 5 billion people on 700 parameters. So that is why they are able to show you those advertisements which you really want. So if you, I'm talking to you on a call, I say ice cream. As soon as I will open my websites, I will see all ice cream ads because they all have pacts with each other. They share data. And a lot of these websites, they have Google AdSense. So they take advertisements from Google feed and Google knows about you. So WhatsApp, you're writing ice cream or you're talking on a WhatsApp call. And Alexa is there. I mean, it hears you, right? So China has done the smart thing. They did not allow these foreign huge companies, which are called FANGs, Facebook, Amazon, Google, Netflix. They didn't allow them. They created their own giants like Baidu, Alibaba, and, you know, WeChat.
Tencent,
yeah. India is a democracy. We are, budget is huge deficit. And the governments come for a short time. So they believe in spending on expenses rather than investing. Dam banega up to subsidy, you will win an election. So a lot of these governments, state governments and the central governments, they have been wasting money. And because of that, investment is not strong. And that is why our GDP would have reached $4 trillion, but it has reached $2.7 trillion. Because all that money, you know, they just expense away, given cost. So, but, you know, all this I'm telling you to tell you about the opportunities which are within this nature of the market. So how the foreign investor sees you, it sees India as a place where it has to achieve PMF, product market fit. If a product and service is selling well in India, you can just plug and play. And it will sell well in 190 other countries. Because India contract enforcement is weak, the courts take a lot of time. So they want to have holding companies in Singapore or outside India. So that any investor coming in can come in the Singapore holding company and not in the Indian subsidiary. Second, they want employees at Indian salaries. So they will keep all employees like marketing and R&D, scientists, everything in India. Back office will be in India. Consumer will be in India. The ownership will be outside. That's what Naukri's founder was talking about in the media. Ye ho kya raha hai, you know, Indian company, Indian employees, Indian consumer, and the benefit of intellectual property outside. The benefit of owning the company outside, paying tax on capital gains on the transaction happening with investors outside. Even the arbitration clauses, if you look at Amazon Future and Reliance fight, which is going on, the arbitration was Singapore. So, you know, we have like East India company situation. But, you know, it throws up a lot of opportunities for the startups who understand all this phenomena happening. Now coming to business plan, which Paras and Pranjal wanted me to discuss. Should I also discuss a little bit about the term sheets which founders get from investors that will help you negotiate the term sheet well with the investor?
Yeah. Paras,
Okay, sure. So what is a term sheet? A term sheet is a document issued by the investor. You have to keep certain factors in mind. First is whether it is a binding term sheet or a non-binding term sheet. If the investor has issued you a binding term sheet, he cannot walk away from the deal. He can lower the price at which he is entering your company because due diligence maybe, you know, throws up some bad factors, but he cannot walk away. A non-binding term sheet, the investor can even walk away at the last signing date. That is one. Second, in the term sheet, the valuation at which the investor is entering and the amount he's putting is mentioned. Then, you know, startups are not able to pay market salaries in many cases. So they pay some salary and they pay some bonus and they keep employee stock option pool. Now, employee stock options are shares which are given to you, but they get vested in 1 year, 2 year, 3 years. As and when you keep on working, you will keep on getting. And it is the responsibility of the company to give you an exit on those ESOPs. Somebody has to buy them, right, at a price so that you get your money. If the company's startup is growing, investor will keep on investing money. So in any such investment opportunity, you will get a chance to sell your ESOP and you make your money. So one of the my friends, his wife was working in a startup. She worked there for 6 to 7 years and she became senior. She was able to sell her ESOP in 6 crore rupees. Now, since the last 2 years, she is not working. She has traveled the world. So that is the opportunity you get. I understand that not all startups become big. So that is a risk also, but it is an opportunity also. Then there are, when the investor is putting in money, how will the investor ensure that he has some rights, some, you know, way so that the company listens to him? That is through the voting rights on the board of directors. Either the investor can have a seat on the board or observer rights. It means that whatever happens in the board of directors, minutes of meeting, and facts considered, anything, the investor will be told about it. He should, that is the observer right. Then there are some info rights. Whenever the monthly balance sheet, quarterly balance sheet, semi-annual balance sheet, yearly balance sheet, audited balance sheet, the investor has to get them. You have to send it to the investor. Then there are certain reserved matters. Now, suppose the investor doesn't have a seat on the board, but he has put a lot of clauses in the reserved matters. What are those clauses? If the company is selling a big asset of which the company owns, the company has to inform the investor. If the company is taking in a CXO at a big salary, it has to inform the investor. If the company is creating a new subsidiary or entering a new country economy market, it has to tell the investor. So it is a huge list. So even if the investor is not does not have a seat on the board, but he has all these rights and he knows what is happening in the company. Similarly, how will the investor get an exit? There are 4 to 5 options which are given in the term sheet. The first option, that the company will come out with an IPO on the stock market. So if the company will come out with an IPO, the shares will start getting traded and the investor can sell his shares. If not, you know, not all companies are able to come out with an IPO. So what will happen if the company does not come out with an IPO? The second option is that the company will appoint a valuer for valuation of the shares in the future and find a third party investor. And the first investor can sell his shares to the third investor by giving him certain internal rate of return, IRR. So usually that is the metric IRR which we use for the investors. Like I use IRR on the investments which I make. And usually my expectation on IRR is around 20-25%. If I get 20-25% annual return IRR, my back, the LP sitting behind me is happy. Third, if the IPO doesn't happen and the third investor does not buy my shares, then the company has to buy my shares from me by giving me my IRR. Now you will be surprised. How can the company buy its own shares? Actually, it is allowed. These are called treasury shares. So Reliance keeps on doing it. They keep on buying their stock from the stock exchange and they keep it as treasury shares as an investment with them. So the company has to buy. If this third option also doesn't happen, then the founder has to buy the shares from the first investor by giving him an IRR, 20% kind of internal rate of return. If that also does not happen, then the company has to look for a strategic investor. What is a strategic investor? A strategic investor and a financial investor are different. Financial investor is just putting in money and he wants to make a return after 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, or in some cases, 8 years. But strategic investor is someone who's putting in money and he's interested in your business also. He wants to, maybe he has a company which has some synergy with your business. And that usually a strategic investor takes 51% equity, like 26%, 30%, 51%, 60%. It's a big chunk. So that is the fifth option, that the company will find a strategic investor. Now, last point in the term sheet is certain clauses. One is ROFR, right of first refusal. It means that whenever the company is getting a new investor, then the company will offer its shares at that time valuation, whatever valuation is prevailing at that time, to the first investor. So he will have a right of first refusal. Secondly, there is a drag along clause. What does a drag along clause mean? It means that suppose the first investor has 25% equity and he's finding a buyer who says, I want minimum 51% equity. Then the investor can drag 26% of the founder's equity, then 25% of investor and 26% of founder means total 51%. And he can sell the 51% to that new buyer of equity. Now, of course, you know, it will be with the approval of the founder because he has to agree to the price also. Last clause is tag along. What is tag along? Now, founder says, I am done with this business. I am not interested. So he says that I am selling my equity to some third party, maybe a strategic investor or maybe a new investor. Then the first investor says, I will tag along with you, as in my shares will also be get sold along with your shares to the new investor. That is what is meant by tag along. So all these clauses are there in the term sheet and they become a part of shareholders agreement also when that is signed at the time of the deal. Okay, so now let me know, Paras and Pranjal, whenever you want to throw the field open for new questions.
Yes, Paras, you could answer.
So right now we can probably take a look at the financials that we have a brief about the pitch deck. Suppose that give a critique, let's say just give it a 5 to 10 minutes. Suppose that we will go ahead with the questions that the people have and some of the questions that further dig deep for the nitty-gritties of financial investment.
Okay. So, you know, before taking up the model, I was in the private equity practice at Deloitte & Touche. So, you know, I will tell you some of my experiences. You might find it funny also. Whenever the startups, they make a financial model, the turnover side, the P&L side, profit and loss, it is going exponentially. Like 1 crore turnover, 60 crore turnover, 8,000 crore turnover, 20,000 crore turnover. It becomes a Nike stick. And whenever they are putting a percentage on the cost, 10% increase, 15% increase, it starts throwing up so many cash flows. You know, I have this company, I got them funded. So they sent me their model. So I was surprised. I said 6 crore turnover and then 50 crore turnover, then 5,000 crore turnover. And they were having 100 crore cash flows in the next 2 years and they were into losses. So, you know, so we had to do a lot of course correction. Now, let me share the screen.
Also, in the meantime, Tushar, for the general knowledge, after Walmart acquired Flipkart, is there a Flipkart India entity or still it is registered with Singapore government?
No, I am telling you, Pranjal, the investor in Flipkart had some known persons who I also know.
Okay.
Walmart invested in Flipkart because it had a holding company in Singapore, because these guys are afraid of the retrospective tax issue with Kane India and Vodafone, which is going on with since almost 10-12 years now.
Right.
So they wanted to be safe. Ki mereko 16 billion, 21 billion dal rao, my money should be safe. You know, so that is the bad blood which was out there. So you are very much right, Pranjal, that they invested because they had a Singapore holding company.
Right.
But you know, again, it is not right. No, your ownership of your companies is going outside India. I mean, end of the day, that I feel as a nationalist, I feel bad about it. So I will just share.
That's a policy problem, and that has to be taken at a.
Yeah. So the government has backtracked on Kane and Vodafone, both issues. So they are saying that agar bahar ka paisa chahiye, toh you have to not play the hard thing. Okay. So this is Sarve Santu Niramaya. Bhadrani Pashyantu. Yehi tha na? Yeah. So this is the pitch deck, which Paras company, it's called Ayush Life. So, you know, generally what is happening nowadays is that any kind of a tech company like this health tech company, then what we do is we have a video pitch deck and which is 3 to 5 minutes. And this pitch deck, now it is telling of the problem, then it is telling the market opportunity, then it is giving a roadmap, then it is giving revenue model, and 50,000, this is the raise, and use of funds is also given. Yes, very good. So typically what we do in this is that that, you know, whenever you are I was sitting in Matrix Partners office in Mumbai. So they said, you know, my startup was a consumer beauty brand startup. So this guy said a very beautiful thing. I remember, forgot his full name, Mr. Agarwal or something. He said that your startup should be solving a major human problem. Now, anybody, you know, in my childhood, my parents said, get a taxi. It was so difficult to get a taxi. I mean, you have to go to these stands where they will be sleeping on, and you have to wake them up and say, bhaiya, you know, ye kali wali gaadi ghar bhej do. And it was such a problem. And now it is on app. It is linked with the map. The pricing is there. I mean, they solved such a basic problem. So your startup should be, I know of this company, Udaan. It is by the IITians only. And I'm really sorry, 60 crore turnover, 550 crore loss, and $1 billion valuation. Now, you tell me, as an investor, I don't have words for it. But the way they justify it is by saying two things. They say that they are creating a tech platform. Secondly, this tech platform will become a monopoly, and because of which all the businesses and customers have to be on the platform. That is what the valuation is for.
But now, is it not the same argument which you are bringing the consumption? So Oran and Cred in the similar manner, I may be wrong. They both are playing, they will become monopoly in one coming times. Consumption is, they are saying, so from you told that our consumption is, India is a consumption company, so they are targeting that, even if they are in losses.
Yes, you are right. They are saying that we will have a data of all the MSME and SME of India, and also, you know, any SME wanting to find a buyer or a customer wanting to search a SME, small and medium enterprise, will have to come to Udaan. And they are extensively using AI and technology to work on the database. So, you know, but, you know, the thing is that they have still to execute. Their turnover is only 60 crores. So this reminds me of Snapchat. Snapchat is used to have Khata Book, like Khata Book and Snapchat both. Snapchat, I think 5 crore turnover or something, and the valuation is $1 billion. Because they have 25 crore daily active users, DAU, which is amazing. I mean, all these are people with vernacular language chats, you know. So Snapchat was the first one who pioneered, and Google is now putting $200 million in at $1 billion valuation. This shows you the power of the data, you know, what this data of Indians means to these people.
That's cool.
I mean,
sorry to interrupt.
Sorry?
That's called ShareChat.
ShareChat. ShareChat, right. That's the vernacular language. I'm sorry. So, you know, TikTok was banned in India. 600 billion or I think something like that user base was coming from India. Look at their valuation. It just fell like anything. So,
How much time the company will always run on the consumption and saying that they have the data? Profitability is one thing which is always told to us. But when you see Udaan, Cred, they are playing at a very different level where profitability is not at all a question. It's the habit they are making it. So, but I think founders are lucky if they are at that level, if they get money to make habit.
But yes, you are right. No, the thing is, now, suppose you have to start a e-commerce business today. Can you escape Flipkart and Amazon? You have to keep your product there because the buyer is there. All your competitors are there. So you have to be there. I mean, it's a moat. You know, the company has such a huge moat that, you know, it's a monopoly. You can't escape it. So habits will be formed according to that only. You are absolutely right.
So we need to think, as you mentioned, that different different ideas such as agri-tech, robotics, to come into the picture. If we get
You should do something which you love. I mean, look at, you know, I'll give you a very beautiful thing to all the startups today. Impact business, which impacts the environment, society, culture. One third of listed companies in the US stock exchanges have impact money, and they are investing in companies who take care of ESG factors, environmental, societal, and governmental. So, you know, people here, they are very, you know, ye to NGO hai, ye to charity hai, ye to ek mandir wala kaam hai, mandir mein crore de denge, lekin waise ek rupya nahi denge. To, matlab, the thing is, it is a big business. I mean, look at Avishkar's investments. They have invested in waste to energy. They have invested in IoT-based agriculture. They are investing in employment, creating microfinance. And anybody wanting to do good for the society and yet making a business, think of an impact business. There is huge money. 950 impact funds in the US. And India, you know, I last counted, I had an impact deal with me, solar deal. 27 impact funds. Loc Capital, Elivar Equity, Avishkar, Shell Foundation, SBI Neev, DFID. I mean, and all sitting on pockets of money. So if you want to do, I mean, making returns in an impact business is not easy. But please be assured, these funds are fully used to under the fact that impact business mein paisa kamana asaan nahi hai, return generate karna. So think of solar, think of something like, you know, there are places in India which can utilize the power generated from the tidal waves, the sea waves. We have such a large coastline. Desalination, water, drinking water generated from desalination. Now, just like so much of research and development happened on solar panels, it happened on lithium-ion batteries, it happened on wind turbines. So the cost of energy produced from these are lower than the fossil fuels like oil and gas. Just like that, a lot of R&D, research and development, will happen in desalination plants. You can just put a desalination plant in Andaman Nicobar. You can put it in the coastal areas and happily get as much water as you want, because water has been added as a commodity on Chicago Mercantile Exchange last month. Water as a commodity. There are 143 dams in the upper riparian places in Mekong River, 143 dams in China on the Mekong River, and 150 dams at the lower riparian countries like Cambodia, Vietnam. This year there was a drought. The Mekong level fell by three meters, and all those countries were in drought. And India's rivers come from Tibet, and China is building dams on all that. I mean, I'm saying, look at the challenge, look at the opportunity. The opportunity in water is huge. I mean, in Punjab, there are electricity is free for farmers. In fact, in a lot of the states, electricity is free for farmers. So instead of making, taking water from the river, they use tube wells and they use groundwater, and the water table is falling like anything. It is because free electricity. So if you have to solve that problem, yes, 2 days back, a beautiful startup came to me. They have pumps which can be used by taking water from rivers, and the pumps, they use solar power to work. And in this budget, the government has allocated, I think, 1,000 crore for solar powered drainage machines. So, you know, look at the opportunity. You know, if you just read more, Google has everything. You know, any skill you want to take in this world is available on the internet for free. YouTube. I mean, be a believer that, you know, I can do it because it is out there free. So, but you know, you have to do what you love and not do something because of, you know, somebody else told you or somebody made you believe something which is not there.
Thank you.
So, yeah.
I have not a question, but we could take a couple of questions from our attendees as well.
Sure.
You have shared the treasure trove of knowledge here, and
No. You guys are like my younger brothers, and all of those who are attending, I want to benefit them because I saw all these things after moving out of college. So I feel it is my responsibility to tell all this to you guys.
Right. So I think if Pranjal allows, can we start taking questions? I can read the questions and
you could take first the question from the Q&A which I posted there. Arunya started asking.
All right. Sure. So Arunya asked, we are looking to raise funding as we have generated revenue since 3 months. So we would like to pitch our idea. Please let us know the procedure, your procedure that you have.
So the way I work is I welcome anyone to approach me. Best way is LinkedIn, and otherwise you can just mail me. I will just like to see your pitch deck, and I would like to, if the pitch deck is not there, then we can fix a time for a call on WhatsApp. I am available on LinkedIn to fix a time as well. And then once I hear it out, because based on my experience, I'm able to see what the other investors will also like or not like. And if on the business side I can help, if on the mentoring side I can help. And that is how I take a decision, and I align accordingly. Whichever way I can help, I'm ready to help.
All right. So Jayadev wants to know whether how to check internally if your business model is going to be liked by the investors.
So you approach 3 investors initially. Aapko pata chal jayega, kisi, some investor will give you a good perspective. They give you a reason for coming on the call. They will give you. Otherwise, you can pitch to different events. I can help you out. I am connected. Actually, I'm on the panel. Tomorrow is IIT Mumbai EE Summit. I am an investor on that, on the panel also. There are 2,000 startups who have registered for the event, and many of them are pitching. So, there is 10,000 startups, Doozy Center of Innovation. There is Startup Monk. There is Startup Buddy. And there are so many events which keep on happening. You'll have to come out of your shell, believe in your business. I'll give you a very interesting thing. This company who they give e-bikes on rent to Zomato and Swiggy and Big Basket drivers. They had come to me 3 years back. I was sitting with them in a hotel coffee shop. And this guy came in, the owner, and he explained everything in numbers. I mean, I told him that, how will you do? The adoption is so low. He said, look at it from top down and bottom up. Top down. China, this is the market size. These many companies came up. These many are selling. This is the number. This is the price they are selling. This is the China market. Now look at India. This is the top market. These many companies are there. It has to grow. It is growing since the last 3 years. Naturally, it is growing. It's a fact. Look at it bottom up. There are 5 companies in China. They have created this kind of business, and people are adopting because the economies of scale is there. The more scale grows, the cheaper the product becomes, the more adoption it has. It is happening in India. These are the last 3-year figures. Everything in numbers. It is not about you, your communication skill, your knowledge, your degrees. It is not about me. Dhanda hai bhai. And dhanda bottom up or top down approach se dekh lo. This is on the paper. Ek ghante tak wo mujhe paper mein samjhata raha. Maine mani man socha. Maine kaha iski funding nahi hogi to kiski funding hogi, And uski funding ho gayi, Within 1 month, I saw it in the papers. I called him up. I said, buddy, you did it. And वो थेरेपिस्ट नहीं होते जो बोन्स को दबा के ठीक करते हैं. He's that. He's not even a technology guy. So, and belongs to a very small city, So just believe in, if you believe in a business, just go for it, It's just about confidence and being at it. That's my suggestion.
Thanks, sir. Jasmeet wants to know, What kind of besides the sales number of the company, do angel or VC investors keep in mind when finalizing with startup or market to invest into? Is it market size, number of investors, or what else other factors are involved?
Okay, very nice question. The earlier the investment, jitna jaldi, you know, the earlier the investment, the more the investor will look at the founder and not so much the business. If it is idea stage or seed or pre-series A, he will definitely want to back the right horse. Kis ghode pe paise lagane, and you know, that founder confidence has to come. You know, if he's getting that feel from the founder, the X factor, you know, that confidence, that But apart from turnover, you know, factors like MVP, your minimum viable, how good is that? Your PMF, your product, you might be having four lines of products, each having a different price, each having different features. You might have done research on maybe 300 secondary research you would have done. And that would be convincing for the intellectual property is big nowadays. And it is so easy to file intellectual property nowadays, you know. So, but, you know, a lot of funds, they also believe in co-investing. So, bahut sare found investors, they will tell you two things. Some founders, some investors will tell you, we will look at your business in next 2 to 6 months. And some investors will tell you, get an anchor fund. I will come along with that, but I won't lead the round. So they want somebody else to take a call. So in that case, what you can do is act smart, as Oyo's Ritesh Agarwal did. Get a term sheet out. If you have a term sheet, you can just tell that to a number of funds that you have a hard commitment, or you can take a commitment on email. It happened with me. So this guy, you know, amazing edtech business, and the first founder is very smart, you know, very well respected in the market. He sent me an email of a Japanese investor. So that was a soft commitment. So I got him his money and the round was completed, and that Japanese investor invested. So all these tactics you can use, but nowadays, you know, after WeWork, you know, the IPO of WeWork fell through. And because that IPO fell through, after that, the investors have become very conscious about unit economics, that, you know, your startup should be not burning only investors' cash. It should also be earning per unit it is selling. So, so you know, turnover is very important. But apart from turnover, EBITDA, which is operating profitability, and net profit, they add to the cash flows. So they are also very important. One another factor is TAM, total addressable market. So a company has come to me, they are into digital out of home. Now the fact of the matter is that all the DOH companies existing in India, if you add up their turnovers, it is 147 or 150 or something like that. So the market is so small. So the investor will think that the TAM is so small, total addressable market is so small, then where will the valuation go? You know, valuation can't really become $1 billion. The other thing is, a lot of these tech businesses, they expand through the internet. And because they expand through the smartphone and the internet, customer acquisition cost, CAC, CAC, that becomes a very important metric, that, you know, your CAC should be reasonable. You can't, you know, I know of this company which got $20 million from Astro Group Malaysia. And they burnt, out of $20 million, they burnt $12 million on Facebook and Google advertising. And they are closed now. So, so you know, any stupid guy can also burn that much cash, right? End of the day, I mean, you have to generate value for the customer. That will generate value for the investor. So, so yes, you know, apart from revenue, other things also matter. A founder market fit, product market fit, and the total market, addressable market size, all these things matter.
Right. So to add on to where the cash burn is happening. At the same time, it's also important that how are they designing the service or the system design in place to bring their perspective. It's just not about the technology, but how do you portray that technology? How do you make that experience? And first is always adoption, and then comes experience. So with technology, these are the two important things one founder should also think about it. And you could reduce drastically your money if you think about adoption, how you are going to adopt. It's just not, internet has many test points. One has to think about that.
So the next question is from Arunya. She said, we are an edtech startup and have already a pitch deck. May I know what investors look particularly in edtech startup for investing?
EdTech, see, content has become very easy to get, you know. There is not much money to be made in content unless you are doing something radically different. Like this company, my client, I told you about, their whole content is in 10 in Indian languages and it is through gamification. So if you look at the content, it looks like you are playing Candy Crush. And they have 35 crore turnover. They're just 3 years old company. And you know, they are earning quite well. 1 year subscription of the app is $1,000. And entire schools are adopting them. Similarly, see, children are not able to go out to play because of the pandemic. So there is all this nervous energy sitting at home and, you know, in front of screens and their body is not moving. So there are psychological issues. So this startup from Gurgaon, they have, see, India mein na psychologist ke paas jana kehte hai, ye pagal ho gaya hai. So, you know, they don't believe in psychiatry as a science. But, you know, talking about your problems opens you up. So this company has child psychologists and they have very simple exercises. The children become very happy and it releases their nervous energy. And, you know, so I'm just giving some examples of what is working in EdTech. Content is difficult. But, you know, if you are simplifying the delivery part of it, main thing is you should be adding to the skill level of the customer. Being in EdTech. A practical skill level. Agar aap practical skill level enable kar rahe ho, if you are enabling that, you will make money. Because it is linked to the job. I'll give you an example of a company. They have videos for teaching and everything is online. They will give you a password. You can access the videos and then you can give an exam online. You will get the certificate online. And they have 75 crore turnover. 75 crores. Why? Because they issue you a online certificate on Naukri.com. So that little certificate, it shows like a badge on your profile. And, you know, it helps you get jobs. Because it helps you get jobs, people are taking their courses. So you should link your output to the customer in terms of whether you were able to provide him a job. If you are able to do that, you will get lots of money. You will itna paisa kamaoge that you won't need an investor. You know, that's the ideal thing. Like Zoho's, you know, Zoho never took outside money and it is $1 billion company. It's amazing. You know,
and he got
the Padma Shri for that. He's on the panel of Ajit Doval's panel for tackling these foreign companies. Yeah, absolutely.
So the basically in tech, it's not about the content, as you said. It's about what chota sa nuance or niche thing which could make the user stick to that and haan, isse mujhe fayda ho raha hai. Varna padhne ke liye to bahut kuch hai. Kitabe hain, internet bhar bhar ke YouTube hai. But why there are many other platforms which are still running and are doing upgrade, kyu alag hai, something else.
So Anders wants to ask, how to approach the markets in different economies. What can be cheap in one country may be too expensive in another country. For a random example, I can talk about data, like internet data. It is very cheap in India, but very costly in US. Or it can be a different product, but it's a more generic question. If Prashant has like answer.
So, see, the basic human traits are the same globally. You know, everybody wants a cheap product. They want it in no time. They want it to be serviceable after they get it. They want it to you know, give them some pleasure. And so, you know, these are all, but, you know, you are right. Markets are different. I'll give you an example. India food consumption at restaurants took a big hit after COVID. But, you know, we Indians, you know, we are used to family food. And we believe in that the woman should cook and we should eat home food. But, you know, this is not the same in Southeast Asia, South Korea, Japan. Everybody eats out, Germany, US. They just don't believe in cooking at home. They keep cold food in the freezer for 7 days. And that's, you know, so naturally, if you are launching a product for the Indian family in the food space, that same product might not see a good traction in other countries. So it will have a different kind of market there than the one here. But when I said that India is used for achieving product market fit, PMF, in most of the cases, if a thing sells well in India, it will sell anywhere nicely and make more money. So this is just a rule of thumb. It's not a exact science.
Mr. Jaydev have asked that he is addressing a burning question of business owners, that how to take business decisions. He has developed a model of making business decision making very easy. There are 22 million SMEs in India. So does it sound interesting as a business? And they have already sold it organically to various business owners. So the proof of concept is there.
Yeah, you know, that is good. I must congratulate you for creating such a product. The investors, they generally stay away from two kinds of businesses. One is trading business, because the turnover does not reflect any underlying value creation. And secondly, services businesses. You know, they are very averse to putting money in consulting business, investment banks, in law services, unless it is addressing some fundamental problem in the market. So you know that you are talking about SMEs, small and medium enterprises. How the businessman of SME thinks, he will only pay for it, for something, if it saves him 10 times more money than what he's paying for. So that is your ballpark formula. You know, that's your formula, back of the hand calculation. If your technique of taking decisions is saving him, you are charging 1 lakh maybe, is saving him at least 10 lakhs, then he won't put in money. But, you know, I'll give you a good example. There is Mr. Jain in Delhi. I won't take his full name. His company, you know, gives workshops to old company owners. And, you know, these old company owners, they're very hands-on. Har cheez they want to do with their own hand. So this company trains them to delegate work and not do everything by themselves. And this company does so many workshops. I mean, he earns like anything. And, you know, he tells them that, you know, just give me your backend data. I will put everything on your WhatsApp. You just have to press buttons and take decisions. Yes, no, yes, no, you know. So he's using a little bit of technology also there.
Jaydev has already mentioned his name. He probably know him. He says Rahul Jain.
Oh, okay. Okay. So I hope I answered that there is a business to be made. I mean, if you are saving 10 times more money for the customer and maybe solving his problem of working capital is a big problem with SMEs, and so now solving some fundamental problem.
Paras, also Jyoti, you could also reach out to Tushar on his LinkedIn. And Paras, there are some more questions Q&A if you have taken or not. Just pointing.
Q&A we have covered almost all the questions. Yes, so Q&A we have already covered all the questions. I would like just one more question. So I don't think some audience is there. So the question is about pre-money valuation and post-money valuation. So if you can just brief a little bit about that, and then the transition.
It's very simple. I mean, a company is an investor is putting $1 million. The company is valued at $5 million. So $5 million is pre-money. After the investor puts in $1 million, post-money valuations becomes 5 plus 1, 6 million. So $5 million is pre-money, $6 million is post-money. Equity stake, which the investor will get, is $1 million divided by post-money valuation, divided by 6 million, whatever that figure is. So it is as simple as that. So, whenever the founders are thinking about problem of valuation, you should study ISAFE. ISAFE is a term used by a founder here, a fund here. But you should study SAFE notes, S-A-F-E, SAFE notes of Y Combinator. So they are very simple instruments. Paisa aaj le lo, you take money today. And whenever the next round of funding will happen, whatever valuation at which that happens, little bit discount to that, the first investor's money will get converted into equity from preference shares to equity. So it's a very simple agreement. It's called SAFE agreement and it's available on Y Combinator website. So you can tell your investors that, right now there is no revenue and it's very difficult to find a valuation. Let us just sign a SAFE agreement and you can convert your preference shares to equity whenever the next round happens and whatever valuation at that discount to that, 20% discount usually.
I think we are that's all with the question.
Okay.
I found that. So have you pasted the link of SAFE financing document from Y Combinator.
Okay. Wow, you are so fast, guys. I mean, you already pasted the link so fast. That's amazing.
So
amazing.
How do you evaluate the companies? What are your parameters? If you can brief on that, and how people can reach you, and what is the good time to reach you? And
so, if I'm not putting in, I have only invested in 4 companies. I'm a very, very cautious investor because I'm not, I'm an engineer, but I'm mostly a finance guy. I'm not a tech guy. I help drive investments into companies. I first make sure whether I will be able to do the case or not. And if I will able to do the case, then I put 2 to 3 months and get the best deal. So I have that topper's mentality. So, that's how I look. Mostly tech companies I pick. Food tech, I do large also. Like food tech, I've done $10 million. Food tech, I can do $25 million also. And anything to do with the quantum computing or AI, can definitely look at large ticket sizes. Otherwise, $200,000 to $5 million is my sweet spot. And I'm able to get investments in those. Definitely, you are please the most happy. Feel free to reach me out on LinkedIn, and I'll be happy to my last count of the relationships which I have built with the funds since 6 to 7 years is almost 230 funds. So I can share a list. All these I know personally, and. That's it. I mean, tomorrow is the IIT Mumbai e-summit. So look to see all of you there. and you know, I can do more sessions, you know, if you guys liked. I don't know whether you liked or not. If you liked, you can put it on chat. I'll be happy. And please feel free to reach me out on my LinkedIn. It's Tushar Kansal.
Thank you, Tushar, for giving us so so valuable time to
thank
us.
You, Pranjay. Thank you, Paras. Paras, you should get a light, you know. We get scared seeing you like this.
Sure, sure. Next.
Yeah. Okay.